Have you ever really, really thought about where money comes from? Not the paper notes or the metal coins, but the actual numbers that show up in your bank account. It almost feels like it just appears out of thin air, right? Well, you're not entirely wrong. The answer is actually way more fascinating than you might think. So let's break it down. This right here is the big question, the one we're going to unravel today. How do banks create money out of nothing? Now, I know it sounds a little bit like magic, maybe even a conspiracy theory, but it's actually the fundamental way our modern economy works. And by the end of this, you're gonna get it completely. So here's how we're gonna tackle this. We have to start from the very beginning, the absolute foundation of money. Then we'll see where banks fit into the picture. After that, we'll see how all of this combines to create the money that we actually use day to day. And finally, we'll wrap it all up with the key formulas that make the whole system tick. All right, let's start at square one. We have to begin with the absolute foundation of all money in the economy. Economists call this the money base, or more simply, M0. You can think of it as the raw material for everything else. So what is M0 exactly? Well, it's pretty straightforward. It's every single physical banknote and every single coin that the central bank, you know, like the Fed in the US or the Bank of Israel, has ever printed and pushed out into the world. If you could somehow gather all of it into one giant pile, that pile would be M0. Okay, so here's the thing. At any given moment, all of this physical cash can only be in one of two places. It doesn't just disappear. It's either in our hands, the public's, or it's sitting inside a commercial bank. And economists have some simple letters for this. We call the cash in our wallets and under our mattresses C for cash held by the public. And we call the cash sitting in the vaults of banks R for reserves. Which means the formula for the money base is incredibly simple. The total, M0, is just the public's cash, C, plus the bank reserves, R. That's it. It's a closed loop. C plus R always equals M0. Let's make this real with an example. Imagine the central bank has printed exactly 1,000 shekels in total. If you and I and everyone else are holding 700 of those shekels in our pockets, then where's the rest? Well, by definition, the other 300 must be sitting in bank vaults as reserves. See? 700 plus 300 gets us right back to our total of 1,000. Now, this is a really key point. What happens if you take 100 shekels out of your wallet and deposit it into your bank account? The amount of cash in public hands, C, goes down by 100. And at the same time, the bank reserves, R, go up by 100. The total M0, it stays exactly the same. We haven't created or destroyed money. We've just moved it from one bucket to the other. So, if just moving money into a bank doesn't create new money, then where does the magic happen? Well, it all comes down to the commercial banks and what they do with those reserves we just talked about. You see, banks don't just let your money sit in a vault gathering dust. Their whole business is lending it out. But, and this is a big but, they can't lend out everything. The central bank sets a very important rule called the reserve ratio. It's the minimum percentage of all deposits that a bank is required to hold onto as reserves and is not allowed to lend out. Let's peek at a super simplified bank balance sheet. On the right, under liabilities, the bank owes 1,000 shekels. That's the money you and I deposited, which we'll call D for deposits. On the left, under assets, is what the bank did with that money. It kept 250 in its vault, as reserves, R, and it loaned out the other 750, L. Notice how both sides have to add up to the same total. So looking at those numbers, what's the bank's reserve ratio? It's pretty simple. You take the 250 it kept in reserves and divide it by the 1,000 in total deposits. And that gives you 0.25, or 25%. And at little calculation right there, that gives us our second key formula, the reserve ratio, which we call little r is just the reserves, R, divided by the deposits, D. And this simple ratio, this is the real engine of money creation. Okay, so we've got the physical money base, M0. And we've got the mechanism banks use, that reserve ratio. Now, let's zoom out and put it all together to see the total amount of money that's actually available for us to spend. We call this M1. M1 is the money that really matters in our day-to-day lives, right? It's the money you can actually use to buy groceries, pay your bills, or order a pizza. And that includes not just the physical cash in your wallet, but also all the digital money sitting in your bank account. So the formula for M1 is the cash held by the public, C, plus all of the demand deposits in bank accounts, D. And pay close attention here. Notice the key difference. For M1, we're using D for deposits, not R for reserves. And this is the big reveal. Let's put them side by side. Both M0 and M1 include C, the cash in our pockets. But M0, the physical base, includes bank reserves, R. M1, the money we actually use, includes total bank deposits, D. And because banks lend out most of the money we deposit, the total amount of deposits, D, is always way, way bigger than the reserves, R. And that means M1 is always much bigger than M0. That extra money, that's the money the banks created when they issued all those loans.
Phew. Okay, we've gone through a lot. So let's just quickly put it all together and recap these three core formulas that really act as the blueprint for this entire system.
First up, the foundation, M0. This is the physical cash printed by the central bank. It's just the cash in our hands plus the cash in bank vaults. Next, the engine, the reserve ratio, little r. This is the rule that tells banks how much they must keep and therefore how much they're allowed to lend out and create. And finally, the result, M1. This is the total spendable money in the economy, which is the cash we hold plus all those deposits created through the lending process.
So if you remember just one thing from all this, let it be this. The vast, vast majority of the money in our economy isn't actually printed by the government. It's created electronically by commercial banks every single time they approve a loan.
And that leaves us with one last really big question. If changing a simple rule like the reserve ratio can literally expand or shrink the entire money supply, who gets to decide what that rule is? And what does that mean for the rest of us when they change it? But that's a story for another time.